So we're going to look at Psalm 8 today. It's quite a short psalm. It's only 8 verses. 9 verses actually, yeah. I'll read it out first and then we'll look at it. So it says, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants you have ordained praise because of your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him, the son of man that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet, all flocks and herds and the beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, all that swim the paths of the seas. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Okay, so again, this is a psalm that is quoted twice in the New Testament, once by Jesus, once in Hebrews, about Jesus. I believe there's a third way in which Jesus is reflected in the psalm, which I'll share a bit later. But first we see this, that it is exalting the name of Yahweh. That's what the psalm is doing. And it does so in a very interesting way. So it starts and ends with the same line. O Lord, our Lord. Or in Hebrew, it's Yahweh, our Adonai. How majestic is your name in all the earth. And again in verse 9, it ends with the same line. O Lord, our Lord, O Yahweh, our Adonai, how majestic is your name in all the earth. So it's a psalm that is proclaiming God's majesty. The word is how majestic, how noble. The older version said, how excellent is your name. That sense of how amazing, how glorious, how wonderful, how marvelous, how majestic God is. And yet when by saying, O Lord, our Lord, there is a sense of transcendence, the sense of Almighty God, but as well as that sense of relationship, intimacy. Yahweh, our Adonai. Okay, even in this, even as he proclaims the majesty and awesomeness of God, there's that sense of intimacy, that sense of relationship. And the reason for that is, what the psalmist is saying in this psalm is this. What David, I can say David, the psalm of David. What David is saying in the psalm is this, is that God's majesty and excellence and glory and awesomeness are not seen primarily in the heavens, which we would think so, his awesome creation, but in fact are seen in what he has on his heart for man. And it's there that we really see how awesome God is. And that is so much in contrast with, I might say other religions, but really idolatry, where what is glorified and what is honored is, I mean, especially, of course, it started with the heavens, with the heavenly bodies, the sun and stars and all of that, the moon also for that matter. And by contrast, the psalmist says in the psalm, David says that despite how amazing the heavens are, we really see God's majesty and we see his awesomeness in man. And he does it in two aspects. So we look at verse 2. It says, you have set your glory above the heavens. Or rather, you whose glory is set above the heavens, the same God whose glory is set above the heavens, from the lips of children and infants you have ordained praise, because of your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. And so he says, yes, you're the awesome God. We see your glory set above the heavens. And yet what is even more amazing is this, that you have ordained praise from the lips of children and infants in order to silence the foe and the avenger. Now, in our Bibles, it says you have ordained praise. Okay, the reason for that actually is one of the cases in our Bibles where we look at the New Testament and translate an Old Testament verse differently. Because in Matthew 21 verse 16, I'll just read it briefly, when the children are praising Jesus in the temple, they're making a ruckus also. And the teachers of the law and chief priests say, you know, stop these kids. Do you hear what they're saying? And Jesus quoted the psalm. Have you never read, from the lips of children and infants you have ordained praise? And the Greek word there is praise, which is why this is translated praise. The Hebrew word actually is strength. The Hebrew word is strength or fortress or stronghold. Okay. And what the psalmist is saying is that even from the babble of infants, comes what you have appointed, what you want to establish, as opposed to the voices and the accusations and the blasphemies of your enemies, and especially the main enemy, who is Satan. Okay. What is there in the babble of infants? Because the word is babes who are suckling, that word for infants. What praise is coming from those lips? What he's saying is that even in that babble of incense is that potential that God has appointed, is the aspect of God's very image, is also the childlikeness that, of course, we know Jesus commends. Okay, these are literally the building blocks of what God has appointed for his kingdom, for his creation. In children and infants, in babes, even in just their babbling, we see God's original purpose. We see the innocence of man and what God wanted to do. And that from that innocent man, God wanted to establish everything he had planned in the earth. And David is saying that it's so awesome. This is God who created the heavens, and he has set his glory above the heavens. And yet look at his awesome purpose. We see in his purpose for man, beginning right there at the beginning, right there when the baby is born and the babble of the baby, we see his purpose. And it is so incredible. It is so awesome. Okay. It is more powerful than the enemy, whether demonic or earthly. And Jesus therefore takes it and gives a specific context to it. And he says that God has ordained praise from the lips of children and infants. And you know, we see that so often, no? When you're bringing up kids, when they're small, there's such a childlike faith, and there's such an innocence, and there's such a beauty in their praise. And God is taking that and doing amazing things. Okay. And so, yes, he has set his glory above the heavens. But he has done even something more amazing in what he has chosen to do with man, right from infancy. And David goes on in the same theme. So he says, when I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place. Firstly, in verse 3, we see God's personal touch in creation. Okay. It is a rebuke to evolution, of course, which David knew nothing of at that time. But the Bible is so clear of how personally God has been involved in creation. Of course, it's not the work of his fingers in a sense, it was literally the word of his mouth. But set in place, appointed, all of it done according to his perfect will. And yet, he says, I consider the heavens, I see all of this, it is so amazing, and all I can think of is how much more amazing is what you feel for human beings. What is man that you are mindful of him, the son of man that you care for him? God, we're nothing in the light of, you know, we look at the heavens and it's often said, no, that we feel so small. But David looks at the heavens and he feels, wow, how amazing. You love me. You care for me. What is man? We're nothing compared to the heavens, and yet you are mindful of him. You care for him. The Son of Man, by the way, of course, later on is used as a picture for Jesus. But the Son of Man here simply means Son of Adam. The word man is Adam. Okay, so God's concern for man is even more amazing than his awesome creation, as seen in the heavens. And then in verse 5, you made him, that is man, a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. Now that's an interesting verse because that word heavenly beings is the word Elohim. And I've taught it before that Elohim can be translated God, and it can be translated heavenly beings. Again, how did they decide whether to say God? Because that would have been fine. God also would have been fine. You made him a little lower than God. Of course, man was made a little lower than God. But again, they look at the New Testament and Hebrews chapter 2, verse 5, where the writer of Hebrews uses this quotation for Jesus himself. He says, there is a place where someone has testified. What is man that you are mindful of him, the son of man, that you care for him? You made him a little lower than the angels. You crowned him with glory and honor and put everything under his feet. And so that word angels is unambiguous in the New Testament. It cannot be replaced with God. And so that's why even in the New Old Testament, it's been translated heavenly beings or angelic beings. Okay. And so David is saying that even though you made us a little lower than even your angelic beings who are part of God's creation, but you've crowned us with glory and honor. And how is that crowning reflected? You have made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet. All flocks and herds and beasts of the field, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, all that's been the parts of the sea. Okay. So God had created, before he created Adam and Eve, or man, he had created the angelic beings, the heavenly beings. And even though he made man a little lower than the angelic beings, he gave all of authority on the earth to man. Okay. I believe that was part of the problem that the angel who became Satan had, that God loved this lower creation so much and gave all dominion to mankind. And of course, verse 6 and 7 reflects Genesis chapter 1, where God says that, let us make man in our image. I'll just read it out, though we all know it. Genesis 1 verse 26, then God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. And David is looking at all of this and saying, this is so much more awesome than the heavens. And, you know, for human beings, really looking at the heavens, the sun, moon, and stars, and the more that we learn about the universe, the more awesome God's creation seems. The more awesome God is as a creator. They didn't know about supernovas and comets and black holes and whatnot. You know, if you remember Louis Giglio's that one talk, which one was that? Indescribable. And he has all those Hubble pictures of, you know, that. I mean, David, I don't know what he had written today. If he could see what was actually there in the universe, what was actually there in the heavens, it was all he could see was little pricks of light. And that was enough for him to wax eloquent. If he could see what all we know, how those things actually look, I can't imagine what David would have been writing and singing. And yet, even more awesome is the fact that God loves us, cares for us, mindful of us, has given us such dominion, such authority. Okay. Now there are two pictures of Jesus in this psalm. One is straight there in Hebrews chapter 2 verse 5, where this, you made him a little lower than the heavenly beings, you crowned him with glory and honor, you made him ruler over the works of your hands, you put everything under his feet. This is seen as, of course, here reflecting man, and that we have earth under our feet, but for Jesus, he has everything under his feet. It's a prophetic word about Jesus who was of course called the Son of Man, that one day God would put everything under his feet, not just the earth, but all of the heavens, everything would be under his feet. It is a type of Jesus. But I believe there's a second type of Jesus in this psalm, which is from the lips of children and infants, you're ordaining praise to silence the foe and the avenger, because in order to silence or to defeat the ultimate enemy, which was the devil and what he had brought, sin and death, God had to send a baby. He did not come as a mighty warrior. He came as a baby. And from what was going to come forth from that baby, of course, it became a man who would silence the foe and the avenger. And so I believe we see a second picture of Jesus here. But the overall sense of the psalm is this, that even though he sees awesome creation, he is not focusing on a distant creator God. A creator God can be very distant. And that is true in other religions and faiths, that the God who is the creator is a distant God. And yet he focuses on the God of covenant, the God who has made a covenant with man, who is of course not lower, not just lower than God, even lower than another category of creation, which is angelic beings. He's even lower than them. And yet God loves man so much. God has placed earth in his care. God is mindful of him. Even the babble of babies is powerful in God's way of thinking, in God's way of doing things. And so at the end, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. We really can't think, we do no longer think of the heavens as a manifestation of that awesomeness. We're thinking of human beings. We're thinking of men and women. We're thinking of babies. And saying, God, this is so amazing. It is a God of covenant, with a God of relationship, with a God of intimacy. And all we can say is, Yahweh, our Adonai. How majestic, how awesome, how excellent, how noble is your name in all the earth. And Lord, I pray that we'll never be worthy, Lord. I pray that we may strive to be worthy of what you think of us, of what value you have given us. Of this authority that we let go of in our sin, but you have restored to us in Jesus. Lord, if from the lips of children and infants you have ordained praise, you have established strength to defeat the foe, God, I pray, make us childlike. Make us like little children, Lord. That what proceeds from our mouths will defeat the foe and the avenger. Bring about your kingdom purposes. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.